Well, let me read a couple passages of Scripture, and then we'll get to what we're going to be looking at this morning. First, I'd like to read Matthew 28, which is the account of the resurrection. And then we'll skip over to 1 Corinthians chapter 15 to look at the first eight verses of that chapter. This is what we read in Matthew 28. Now, after the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to look at the grave, and behold, a severe earthquake had occurred, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled away the stone and sat upon it. And his appearance was like lightning, and his clothing as white as snow. The guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who has been crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, just as he said. Come, see the place where he was lying. Go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And behold, he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you." And they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to report it to his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and greeted them, and they came up and took hold of his feet and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and take word to my brethren to leave for Galilee, and there they will see me." Now while they were on their way, some of the guard came into the city and reported to the chief priests all that had happened. And when they had assembled with the elders and consulted together, they gave a large sum of money to the soldiers and said, "You are to say, 'His disciples came by night and stole him away while we were asleep. And if this should come to the governor's ears, we will win him over and keep you out of trouble.'" And they took the money and did as they had been instructed. And this story was widely spread among the Jews and is to this day. But the 11 disciples proceeded to Galilee, to the mountain which Jesus had designated. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some were doubtful. And Jesus came up and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." And then let's skip over to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And here Paul tells us the importance of these events that we've just been reading about. He says, "Now I make known to you, brethren, the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, in which also you stand, by which also you were saved, if you hold fast the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 brethren at one time, most of whom remain until now, but some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared to me also." Now we could go reading through this chapter. The entire chapter is actually devoted to the importance of the resurrection. He's going to remind us that if Jesus was not raised, then we also, well, we should say when we die, we will perish. The resurrection is very important. We're going to look at the importance both of his death and resurrection this morning. Now, again, I don't think I have to tell you because I've already told you that we are reflecting today on what are the most important truths that really are in the world or in the creation. That Jesus died, that he was buried, and that on the third day he rose again from the dead, that he might be the Savior of all who believe. These things are really at the very foundation of the Christian faith. This is the gospel. This is the good news. This is the message that God has given to us, which if we believe it, as Paul has just told us, and if we trust in the one who has died and has risen, we will be saved. Saved from what we justly deserve from the hands of God for the crimes that we've committed, the sins we've committed against Him. From a place, the Bible tells us, is a place of eternal pain and torment. And we will be brought safely through this world and brought eventually into a world that is a perfect world of love and joy. Now, if we've trusted Jesus, this is also the message that He has entrusted to us to share with others that they too might be saved. That's, of course, what the Great Commission is about that Jesus gave to His disciples at the end of Matthew chapter 28. This morning, I would like for us to again remember or to consider these things, that Jesus died and rose again. Why it's important that He did. And then thirdly, what difference this can make in our lives. So first of all, let's consider the facts of the gospel, that Jesus died and rose again. Now, I want us to back up just a bit and reflect, first of all, what we read about in our meditation. As the day of Jesus' death was approaching, how He presented Himself to the Jews as their Messiah by riding into Jerusalem on a donkey. And that was to fulfill Scripture. One thing about Matthew's gospel, perhaps you've noticed, is that Matthew, who was Jewish, and although he was hated by the Jews because he was a tax collector, and perhaps hated even more because he became a disciple of the Lord Jesus, he was a Jew. And he understood the Old Testament. And over again, he was pointing out how Jesus and the things that He did was fulfilling the Old Testament Scriptures, exactly what God said Messiah would do hundreds, if not thousands, of years before it took place. Well, he points out that on this particular occasion, when Jesus rode into Jerusalem on a donkey, He was fulfilling what the Lord said Messiah would do many years before it took place. Zechariah the prophet says in Zechariah 9, verse 9, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout in triumph, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and endowed with salvation, humble and mounted on a donkey, even on a colt, the foal of a donkey." I've already pointed out to you when David wrote about the crucifixion of our Lord in Psalm 22, he wrote that nearly 1,100 years before the event actually took place. Here, Zechariah, who was ministering to the exiles from Judah who had returned to Jerusalem to rebuild the temple in 520 BC, wrote these words roughly 553 years before the event took place. And the reason I'm emphasizing this is simply to point out that this is one of the many ways, a very important way, that we understand that the Bible is not just human writing. It is God's Word. And the way we know that is because only God knows the future. And this is why He tells us what's going to happen hundreds or sometimes thousands of years before it actually takes place, so that when it takes place, we will see that it actually is. But the Lord has Zechariah write this down for another reason, and that is so that when it happened, when Jesus entered into Jerusalem in this way, the Jews would know that He is their Messiah, that He is the rightful King of Israel. Zechariah writes, "Behold, your King is coming to you," and He was coming to save. Now again, they may have thought that Jesus or the Messiah was coming actually to save them from the tyranny of Rome, and I think a lot of Jews actually believed that, but He was coming to save them from something that was far worse than the oppression of Rome. He was coming to save them from their sins and the oppression of Satan over them because of their sins. Now again, as important as His presentation to Israel was, Jesus did not come to Jerusalem merely to present Himself as king. He came to die. He came to be raised again from the dead in order that He might be exalted over all the creation as the king over all things. Now this was also something that was predicted even further back in the Old Testament scriptures. This is what the Lord had in mind from the very beginning when he pronounced the curse upon the serpent, upon the devil after the fall. He says in Genesis 3:15, "And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise you on the head, and you shall bruise him on the heel." This was really the first promise of the coming of the Messiah, which took place right after the fall of our first parents. He was talking about how Jesus was coming to crush Satan, but in the process he himself would be wounded. He would actually die. This is certainly what the Old Testament sacrifices were picturing. The one who was going to take away sin by sacrificing himself. Remember what John the Baptist said when he saw Jesus coming out to him in order to be baptized in John chapter 1, verse 29. He says, "Behold, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." He was called the Lamb of God because he was going to give his life in order to cleanse his people from their sins. His resurrection and exaltation that would come following his death was what David was actually speaking about, again, 1,000 years, 1,100 years before it took place in Psalm 110, verse 1, where he says this, "The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet." And if we had read the psalm that I originally intended to read for our call to worship, David there also reminds us that the Lord would not allow his Holy One to remain in the grave and to see corruption. He would be raised again from the dead. Jesus was entering into Jerusalem to die, but he wasn't going to remain dead. He was going to be raised again. We know that Jesus entered into the city on Sunday. He preached and he taught throughout the week until Thursday. On Thursday evening, he celebrated that final Passover with his disciples, and then he went to Gethsemane to pray. And it's in Luke's account where it talks about Jesus, as it were, as he's wrestling with his Father in prayer, as he's struggling, asking for the grace and strength to be able to do what the Lord called him to do, that he begins to sweat blood. Blood because of the duress, the stress he was under, looking forward to what was going to take place, not just the crucifixion. We don't read that these prisoners, the thieves that were on either side of him, they were sweating blood before they were crucified because they were merely being crucified. Jesus was going to bear the sins of his people and endure God's wrath. Well, he prayed in the garden. He was arrested in the garden, put on trial early Friday morning, mocked, beaten, crucified, died and buried on the same day. But on the third day, which is the first day of the week, he rose again from the dead. So these are the facts. These are the facts of the gospel. Jesus died, and Jesus rose again from the dead, as we've just read from the scriptures. Now, how do we know that these things actually took place? How do we know that Jesus died and rose again? Well, we take it for granted that we believe these things because we know what it is we're reading. But from a human perspective, we can know in the same way that we know anything to be true that we haven't actually personally witnessed by reading the written accounts of those who did see what took place. I mean, we haven't witnessed everything that's taken place in the world, and yet we know there are things that have taken place in the world. We know that these things, or we believe them to be true. But that's because people wrote about them who actually saw them, and we believe what it is that they saw. Well, we have the same thing here, at least humanly speaking. There were many who saw Jesus die on the cross, many standing around him when he yielded up his spirit, and he says, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit," and he died. But if there was any question that Jesus had actually died, those questions were laid to rest when a soldier who was standing near him took a spear and thrust it into his side just to make sure. We read in John 19, verses 32 through 37. "So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first man and the other who was crucified with him." I should mention the reason why they were breaking legs was because the Jews came to Pilate and they said, tomorrow's the Sabbath. We don't want these folks on the crosses during the Sabbath. So could you make sure they're dead so we can take them down and bury them before that happens? So he ordered the soldiers to go out and break their legs. And if their legs were broken, they would suffocate. They would die relatively quickly. But notice, coming to Jesus, when they saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood and water came out. Why did he do that? Well, for two reasons. One, to make sure he was dead. Secondly, to fulfill Scripture. Notice what John writes. And he who has seen has testified, and his testimony is true. And he knows that he is telling the truth, so that you also may believe. For these things came to pass to fulfill the Scripture. Not a bone of him shall be broken. And again, another Scripture says, they shall look on him whom they pierced. So we have all the witnesses standing around him. We have the soldier who pierced his side. We have John's testimony. These things took place. We also have three other eyewitness accounts, one from Matthew, whose gospel we've been reading this morning, one of Jesus' disciples. We have Mark's testimony, which is essentially Peter's account of what took place. We have Luke's testimony, a Greek physician and a convert to Christianity who may not have witnessed these things personally, but who interviewed the people who actually did see them and put together these accounts that he might send them to a Greek believer in the Lord Jesus Christ so that he might know the exact truth of these things. Now, all of these not only witnessed his death, they also witnessed his resurrection. And to this group, we can add the Apostle Paul, who was converted shortly after Jesus' resurrection, and the over 500 people who all saw him at the same time and in the same place. Now, the Bible tells us that two or three witnesses are enough to establish any fact, but the Lord has given to us far more than that to his death and to his resurrection. So again, we have eyewitness accounts. Now, these accounts, secondly, are recorded in a book that claims to be the Word of God, and a book that we know is the Word of God. We've just seen one of the many ways that it shows itself to be the Word of God by telling us what's going to happen long before those events actually took place. Now, if we had several hours to spend on this, we could look at many, many other ways the Word of God actually shows itself to be the Word of God. If God has given to us these accounts, they obviously must be true because God does not lie. But thirdly, we have the witness of the Holy Spirit. The one who not only authors the Bible, the one who gave us the Bible, he's the one who inspired it, if I can use that word, but he's also the one who illumines its pages to show us the truth of these things, to convince us that this is the Word of God and that what it says actually is true. That's particularly true if we are believers, because the Spirit of God allows us to see the glory of God in the Word of God. When we read this, we see it as something different than any other book that we might possibly read. There is something divine about it, and we see that because of the Spirit's work. But the Spirit also sometimes bears witness to unbelievers who read it as well to show them the truth of these things. And so how do we know these things took place? We have the testimony of several eyewitnesses, not the least of which is God himself. Now, secondly, why is it important that Jesus died and rose again? Well, to put it simply, if Jesus had not done this, all of us would be doomed forever. God tells us in his word that we have all sinned against him. We have all broken his commandments. We have all committed crimes against him. Now, we don't have time to go through all the commandments to point this out, but let me just simply use the summary that the Lord gives us of the law. Have we loved the Lord our God with all of our heart and mind and soul and strength? From the time we were conceived in the womb to the present, have we done that? Have we loved our neighbor as we love ourselves? Or as Sinclair Ferguson would put it, have we loved our neighbor as Jesus has loved us? All of us have fallen short. None of us have done what the Lord has called us to do. As a matter of fact, we've done quite the opposite. We've all fallen short of what the Lord commands us to do, what He calls us to do. And He has the right to call us to do what He wants us to do because we are His creation. We owe that to Him. But we should also do it because what He calls us to do is the right thing to do. But we haven't done the right thing. We haven't done the loving thing. Paul writes in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We have all broken the commandments, and because we've broken the commandments, we deserve everlasting destruction." We'll get to why we deserve that in just a moment. So we don't deserve heaven. What we do deserve is death. Again, Paul writes in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death." That's what sin deserves. That's what the breaking of the commandments is, well, really what the only thing God can justly require of us for breaking these commandments. And when Paul tells us that the wages of sin is death, he's not talking about merely physical death, the kind of death that every single one of us is going to face one day, but he's talking about eternal death, the wrath of God that we deserve for the sins that we have committed. He's talking about our suffering forever in hell. That is what we deserve. That is judicial death. The death we deserve for breaking God's commandments and rebelling against Him. Now that is why we needed salvation. That was our situation. And there was really nothing we could possibly do about it because there's nothing we could do, nothing we could pay, nothing we could give God to reverse it somehow. We would already owe Him this debt that we could never repay. And even if we obeyed Him perfectly from the time we discovered this, which we can't, to the time that we died, we would only be doing what was required of us to begin with. We could never go back and pay for the sins that we had committed. The only one who could do anything about this was God, and He did by sending Jesus into the world. Now remember, when we broke God's commandments, we were not just sinning against another person who has, you know, limited value. We all have, you know, finite or limited value. We sinned against God, one who is infinitely worthy, one who is infinitely holy. The only just penalty for the crimes that we have committed against Him would be to suffer for them. But since we could never suffer enough, we could never actually pay for them, even if we suffered for an eternity. But there is one who could pay for these sins, and thankfully one who has. The Bible says that Jesus is the Son of God, God in our nature, the one who came into this world to obey for us and one who was able to pay this debt for us from our side because He is man, but also to give a payment that is valuable enough to completely discharge our debt because He is also divine. He is the eternal Son of God. This is the one the Father sent into the world to save, the one who was willing to lay down His life so that all who believe in Him, all who trust Him, all who receive Him might live. So it was important that Jesus come into the world. It was important that He be both God and man. It was important that He die. The wages of sin is death. That He not only die physically, but that He also endure God's wrath on the cross, that He die judicially and in order to discharge or to pay for our sins. But it was also important that He rise again from the dead. Why is it that Jesus actually died on the cross? Well, it's because on the cross, the sins of everyone who would trust in Him were actually credited to Him, and He bore them. And because He was charged, as it were, with those sins, though He did not personally commit those sins, He was the one whom the Father would hold accountable or guilty of those sins in his judgment. The wages of sin is death, and so those sins required his death. He paid the price, but once the price was paid, death could no longer hold him in the grave. If Jesus had not been raised from the dead, this would mean that those sins that he carried had not been paid for, which means that if he had not been raised, then everyone who had trusted in him would perish, and this may almost sound irreverent, but they would have perished with him. You see, if Jesus bore those sins, if he took those and the responsibility to pay for him and his payment on the cross had not paid for those sins would have weighed him down into the grave, into hell forever. So not only would we have perished, but Jesus would have perished, which is unthinkable. It could not happen that way. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 17 through 19, if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless. You are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If we have hoped in Christ in this life only, we are of all men most to be pitied. But Paul writes in verse 20, but now Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who are asleep. And the reason why he rose from the dead was because the sins that he carried were paid for in full. Death had lost its grip on him. Because he lives, we will also live. And that's what the resurrection actually means for us. It means this morning that if you are trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ, Jesus paid for your sins. Jesus discharged your debt. Jesus overcame death for you. Now, you will still die physically. At least you will if you die before Jesus returns. Your soul will go to be with him in heaven, but your body will go into the grave and will return or turn back into dust. But of course, when he returns, he will raise that body again to life and reunite it with your soul. You will not die spiritually. You will not die eternally. You will not die judicially, even though you still will die physically. He has set you free from judgment, from what you would have faced for your sins. He's taken away your guilt. He's given you a perfect record of obedience. So what this means for you is if you're trusting Jesus, when you die, you will go to be with him. When you are raised again from the dead, when he returns and you stand before him on the day of judgment, he will acquit you. He will say not guilty, and he will actually receive you to himself. And he will bring you into that new world that he's going to create. Because the Lord Jesus Christ lives, you will live as well. That's what it means for those of us who are trusting Jesus. But it also means for those of you who may not be trusting the Lord Jesus this morning, for those of you who, whether you realize it or not, are still faced with judgment, that there's hope. Jesus, through his work, is offering salvation to everyone. He offers to forgive you and to give you that perfect righteousness that you need in order to enter into heaven if you will only come to him, if you will only trust him. Now again, that means you need to go beyond just simply knowing the facts of the gospel. You need to go beyond just believing that those things are true. You actually need to trust in the Lord Jesus. Turn from your sins and trust in him to save you. The Bible says there's nothing you need to bring to him. There's nothing you can bring to him. Jesus has done it all. All you need, to put it in terms perhaps we're familiar with, is to see your need of him. All you need to do is look to him. Listen to what Jesus says in John 13, verses 14 through 17. As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, so that whoever believes in him will in him have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him. And Jesus also says in John 11, verses 25 through 26, to Martha, when he was comforting Martha over the death of her brother Lazarus and the fact that he will live again, he says, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even if he dies. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? Well, Jesus asks you this morning, if you haven't trusted him, do you believe what he just said is true? If you do, and if you're willing to trust him, then today can be the day of your resurrection. If you will turn from your sins, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, if you will trust him to make you right with God, he will do it. He invites you to come. And he says, the one who comes to me, I will not cast out. You never have to be afraid that Jesus is going to turn you away. If you want him, come to him, and he will give himself to you. He will give you everything you need in order to enter into heaven. He will save you from your sins, that you might be with him one day in heaven. If you don't know Jesus, trust in him this morning. Well, let's take a moment, shall we, and bow in silent prayer, and let's ask the Lord to take what we've heard and to apply it to us as we need to hear it this morning. Let's pray.